great to have you along for this program of Hope Today. What a blessing it will be for all of us as we enjoy music and word about the greatest and really only message of eternal hope and faith. We are going to have a great hour together. I imagine you can remember a time when someone offered you an act of kindness when you were not expecting it. Or what about the time when you had the opportunity to bless someone with a gift of kindness? Do you remember the impact? In this program, Pastor Tom Cullen will be considering the kindness of God as exemplified in the life of Joseph. Listen for this wonderful message in a moment. In these next moments, Mac Wigfield will come with blessings in music for our inspiration.
And I welcome you to Gospel Music on Hope Today. As you hear the strains of John Newton's classic Amazing Grace in the background, that's exactly what we'll be talking about today, particularly in the life of Joseph. Let's begin with a song by the Adoration Quartet.
Grace is a gift to the one that's undeserving. It's first prize to the runner that comes in last place. It's freedom for the one who's been proven guilty. It's unmerited favor. It's duty. Forgave me. I knelt at the altar to seek his dear face. I called on his name in faith and believing, and that's when I saw him through beautiful grace. Grace, grace, God's marvelous grace, given by the Father. Mountain,
take my grace.
And the question might well be asked for us as well as the young lad Joseph, where would we be without the grace of God? Because life, yes, by His grace, it is also intended for His glory. Here's the Evidence Quartet.
Where would I be without Your love? What kind of life would I be guilty of if not for Your redeeming hand that reached so low to raise me up and let me stand by Your grace and for Your glory? I am here to tell the story of all the doors You've opened for me, that I might give, I might love, I might for Your glory.
Not by my strength have I survived my reckless steps and my selfish pride.
I don't know about you, but I love living in grace. This is Three in Company.
When I think about the Ten Commandments on the wall, how if just one is broken, then we're guilty of them all, and that a holy God demands a sacrifice be made, it makes me think of Calvary and
thank you. It's so good to have you with us on Hope Today as we think about the kindness of God. It is a quality that we see expressed as we continue our study of the life of Joseph in the Old Testament book of Genesis. When people think of God, they sometimes don't think of his kindness. They think of his wrath or judgment or anger. But Scripture clearly tells us that God is kind. So the refrain we read over and over, "The Lord is gracious, compassionate, slow to anger, and abounding in love." Stay with us as we see God's kindness working on the lives of Joseph's mean-spirited brothers. Here's Red Rocks Worship with Again and Again.
When the doubt in my way tries to steal what you say, saying I have no reason to praise, I will give thanks.
Come on. Yeah.
Oh, I will give thanks. When the roar that I hear is the voice of my fear, trying to silence this hope in my heart, I will give thanks. Oh yes I will. Oh I will give thanks.
Come on church, sing it out.
Oh. A song of thanksgiving is my battle cry. With joy as my weapon I stand and defy the lie of the dark with my hands lifted to the sky.
Now
In our study of the life of Joseph, we've arrived at the part of the story where he's become prime minister of Egypt and his brothers come to him looking for food for their starving households. But they don't know it's him. They don't recognize the one they sold into slavery all those years ago. It plays out better than any primetime drama as God seeks to bring them to a place where they admit their wrong and trust in him. He's worked on their conscience through pressing need and quiet solitude. Today, we see him speak to them through his kindness. As Joseph's brothers are about to leave, he orders his servants to fill their satchels with grain and secretly give them back the silver they used to pay for the food. So you can imagine their shock in Genesis chapter 42, verse 28, when they find out that the silver had been returned to them. The text says that upon the discovery, their hearts sank and they turned to each other, trembling. They were afraid. The implication was that they had stolen the money, and now, if and when they returned to Egypt, they would not only be accused of being spies, but thieves too. But the truth is, Joseph in his kindness had given the silver back to them, and they got the grain for free. How generous, how forgiving, how wonderful was Joseph's kindness. It was another means to bring the brothers to a place where they recognized their sin and asked for forgiveness. But it's also a picture of God's kindness toward you and me. It is a kindness that does not count our sins against us, but lavishly gives us life and joy and peace and hope. It is a kindness that is meant to bring us to himself and know forgiveness of sin through faith in his Son, Jesus Christ. So the Masters Four sing, God's Amazing Grace.
Oh, it was grace
that pardoned me and taught my soul to sing.
Oh, it was
grace that rescued me and covered everything.
Amazing grace.
Grace that strengthens me until he comes again.
Yes, it's
grace, sweet grace, God's amazing grace.
Well, I had heard that Jesus came to set the sinner free, but I had never thought that meant he came for one like me. Then I discovered that his love was shown upon a tree, and by his grace he saved my soul and gave me victory.
Oh, it was grace.
Grace that pardoned me and taught my soul to sing.
Oh, it was grace.
Grace that rescued me and covered everything.
Amazing grace.
Grace that strengthens me until he comes again.
Yes, it's
grace, sweet grace, God's amazing grace.
Grace does not apply to you, and that you'll get to heaven based upon the things you do. But Jesus said, believe in me, 'cause I'm the only way, and you can have eternal life if you believe today.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch. Soul to sing.
Oh, it was grace.
Grace that rescued me and covered everything.
Amazing grace.
Grace that strengthens me until he comes again.
Yes, it's
grace, sweet grace, God's amazing grace.
Oh, yes, it's
grace, sweet grace, God's amazing grace.
When Joseph's brothers come to him for food, they don't recognize him, but he sends them on their way with food to spare plus the money they brought to pay for the food. As they travel home, they discover the silver in their satchels and their hearts sink and they turn to each other trembling and say, "What is this that God has done to us?" Interestingly, this is the first time the brothers mention God in the whole of the story. It's such a contrast to Joseph, who seems to talk about God or mention God in every other sentence. God clearly is at the center of Joseph's life, but his brothers? Not so much. But now, with their money returned, they ask, "What is this that God has done to us?" It's a breakthrough in their character. They are finally recognizing that God is at work in their midst. Now, to be clear, they knew about God. After all, they were Jacob's sons. They would have heard the stories of Abraham and Isaac and the covenant God made with them. They knew all about God, but they didn't have a relationship with God. They knew him as a character in a story who visited their ancestors on starry nights and barren plains. God wasn't God to them. This is why this statement is so significant in their journey. Here, for the first time, they are recognizing that the living God was interacting with them. Have you come to the point where God is God to you? You may have spoken his name in abbreviation, OMG, or maybe said, God bless you, after someone sneezed, or exclaimed, God only knows. That's not knowing God. It's simply using his name in the void. God can be known, and in his loving kindness, he makes himself known. Here's City of Light with Jesus Strong and Kind.
Jesus said that if I thirst, I should come to him. No one else can satisfy, I should come to him. Jesus said if I am weak, I should come to him. No one else can be my strength, I should come to him. For the Lord is good and faithful, he will keep us day and night. We can always run to Jesus, Jesus strong.
Psalm 23 gives us beloved words that have undoubtedly provided much comfort and encouragement to God's people through the centuries. In times of deep need, our minds run first to these tender words from King David. They minister so meaningfully to our wounded spirits, as they did to the psalmist. Often called the Dean of Contemporary Music, John W. Peterson was born in November 1921. Being trained at Moody Bible Institute and then the American Conservatory of Music, he has written more than 1,200 gospel songs and has supplied church choirs and youth groups with more than 25 cantatas. Many of his songs continue to be published in most of the hymnals used today for Christian ministry and worship. Co-composer of our hymn today was Alfred B. Smith. He was also born in November, but in the year 1916. He too studied at Moody Bible Institute and later at the Juilliard School of Music. Throughout his life, Alfred was involved in editing and publishing many popular songbooks and hymnals. He wrote approximately 500 gospel songs and choruses. Let Jesus, the kind shepherd, find and lead you too, as you listen to Ray Walker and the Jordanaires lead a congregation as they sing, Surely Goodness and Mercy.
Joseph's brothers experienced kindness in the face of their terrible sin. They had sold their brother into slavery and staged his death. They then lied to their father, telling him a wild animal had devoured him. But when they finally come face to face with Joseph, they don't recognize him. After all these years, they never expected him to have become prime minister of the greatest nation in the ancient world. But Joseph recognizes them, and he shows them kindness, generosity even, secretly returning to their bags the money they had brought to purchase food. This is the kindness of God. He doesn't wait for us to clean ourselves up before he shows his loving kindness. He doesn't wait for us to reach a level of obedience before he blesses us. He doesn't demand that we reach a station of holiness before he speaks to us. No, in his great grace, he reaches out to us, showering us with kindness even before we know him or call out to him. Having experienced kindness, Joseph's brothers now recognize God is at work. Truly, God's kindness, his grace, is a means to open people's eyes to his presence and work in their lives. Has this happened to you? Do you see God's gracious kindness at work in your life, in the air that you breathe, the freedom you enjoy, the bread that you eat? They are all signs of God's grace toward you, and they are meant to bring you to himself. Sadly, so many are blind to God's kindness and never turn to him in repentance and faith. But it doesn't have to be that way for you. God has arranged it so you listen to today's program and realize that he loves you, is kind towards you, and wants you to put him first in your life. Here's Jesus Culture with 10,000 Reasons.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship his holy. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship his holy.
Joseph acts graciously toward his brothers who sold him into slavery. It won't be the first time that he extends the hand of kindness to those who betrayed him. In fact, this first act of kindness, returning the money they had brought with them to purchase food, was a foretaste of the great banquet he would prepare for them when they returned. That would be a feast of grace. So with the kindness that God shows you each day. Each act of grace that you receive from God's hand is meant to point you to the wonder of His Son, Jesus Christ. In grace, God sent His Son to be a sacrifice for your sin and mine. Out of grace, Jesus died the death that we were to die, and He took on the wrath of God that we were to experience. He died for us and instead of us. What grace! We've done nothing that Jesus should die for us. We haven't performed some ceremony that would win His favor. We haven't attained a level of holiness that He should give His life for us. We haven't been so good that we merited His sacrificial death. We're sinners. But hear the good news. We are loved. You are loved. God, in His love for you, is willing to pay the price that you cannot pay. In His kindness, He's willing to pick you up from your sin, clean you up by His sacrifice, and make you what you've always intended to be, His child who reflects His character to the world around. Can you see God's kindness toward you in the small mercies you receive every day? Allow them to lead you to the great truth that God in His mercy has given you His Son, Jesus Christ, to die on a cross. Admit your sin to Him and know His forgiveness and life today. Sarah Pearson sings, Grace, Greater Than Our Sin. You're listening to Hope Today, and we're celebrating the truth of God's kindness. Of course, His kindness is supremely revealed in the sacrificial death of Jesus Christ. It is the rock upon which we're able to stand before God with joy. So Avalon testify in The Solid Rock.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. Trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name.
When darkness veils His lovely face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds with
Joseph returns the money, his brothers paid for their food, and it was an act of grace. Unfortunately, the brothers don't understand the act. They are terrified, and they think that they will be punished. And they cry out, "What is this that God has done to us?" F.B. Meyer, a preacher from a previous generation, said this, "A guilty conscience misinterprets the kindest gifts and mercies that God sends to us, and with evil ingenuity distills poison out of the sweetest flowers. How often," he continues, "like these men, we cry, 'What has God done to us?' and are filled with fear when, in point of fact, God's dealings with us brim with blessing and are working out a purpose of mercy that shall make us rejoice all our days." My friends, will you pray with me? O God, open our eyes to your daily acts of kindness toward us. May they lead us to the truth of Jesus Christ, who out of your grace died for us, that we would rejoice all of our days. Amen. Fellowship Creative sing Grace on Top of Grace.
Lord, how you've loved me, I don't deserve grace on top of grace. Of grace, how sweet the sound, once lost, now found. Heaven came down in grace, rescue me. Hallelujah, I am free from the sin and penalty. At the cross you took my place, with your grace on top of grace. Hey! Come on, lift your voices. How you love me, Lord, how you love me, I don't deserve grace on top of grace. More than I ask for, more than I'm worth, grace on top of grace.
The greatest example of kindness has been provided to each of us by God Himself. Through His love and kindness, we can experience real life, joy, and happiness for all eternity. Thank you, Pastor Tom, for this wonderful message today. You may want to hear this program or a previous one again, or you may want to share a program with a friend. You can do all that by visiting www.lightandlife.ca. Once again, that is light, the letter N, and the word life. Through the website, you can send Pastor Tom and our team a note. We would love to hear your story. Hope Today is produced at Straight Path Studio. We look forward to being with you and your friends next time for another program of hope. Until then, keep looking ahead. Jesus is coming again. At the cross, you